So just to start, curious what people thought about Farouk Elbaz. Thumbs up, neat. Colorful, that's good. Anything else?
I thought it was interesting how critical he was of scientists, astronauts.
Yeah.
That was unexpected. Jack Swagger.
If I can just throw it out there, from working for the government before, actually the scientists are always the worst at it. And I love the way he described it, because it's exactly the experience that at least I've had, where the people who are really smart about the stuff and actually kind of know what they're talking about, they're so interested in the general theory that they actually can't accomplish the mission. So you never, or at least in the military side of things, you never want to send a scientist into the field, because they'll be so busy, you know, looking at the rocks or whatever it is that they find fascinating to like actually get what they were there to get done. Mm-hmm. So I was entertained to see that also happened.
Yeah.
Let me comment on that, going back to the discussions we were having about the Russian differences. A group of us from MIT were in Russia at their equivalent of the Johnson Space Center when it was still the Soviet Union, and were shown around their equivalent of the Mission Control Center, and I, as a scientist who's been on missions, said, well, they showed me where the guidance and control people and the communications people. I said, where are the scientists? He said, very far away. And this was a mission director who had been responsible for the Mars mission, which was sent off course because of a semicolon that was a result of a scientist saying, well, as long as we're on the way to Mars, let's put in this additional command and get some more data. So, I mean, it's a view which is certainly expressed on both sides of the ocean, one I violently object to, of course. but mistrusting the scientist when it comes to the nuts and bolts engineering.
I wonder if part of that view, so what popped into my mind when that started coming up is sort of this line between looking at the astronaut as a scientist, as an active explorer who's there and thinking about things on the spot, versus an engineer, and I know this is hyperbole, but an engineer would be more of an intelligent instrument of exploration that is doing things for scientists to analyze on the ground, as opposed to being up there to do on the spot, everyone does on the spot thinking, but sort of active science at the location.
Yeah.
And it may be that part of the disdain for scientific astronauts would be that the people on the ground get the sense that the people up there are doing more of their job as opposed to the job that they have been sent there to do, which is just to collect the data.
So. Yeah, no, I think that's right, and it's a very interesting view that you know, I think for practical purposes, you can say, and Dave Scott will probably confirm this, that the astronauts ended up having about master's level knowledge of geology. You know, they did about a master's degree worth of geology. And, you know, certainly Farouk considered them like highly trained technicians, which was what he liked, as opposed to doing the science. Now, there's obviously then also some kind of competitive thing with, you know, without Jack Schmidt up there, the geologists on the ground are the kings of the geology, and with Jack Schmidt up there, it's a very different story. But it raises this interesting issue about, like, where is the science actually getting done? By whom? When? When a couple of years ago we had Bob Parker, who was an old friend of Larry's, come in, who was a Skylab astronaut. He had been chosen during the Apollo program, but he flew on Skylab. And also,
actually, he flew after Skylab.
After Skylab. Okay. He wasn't on Skylab? No, maybe it was early shuttle.
No, but continue what you're saying, because I'll comment on Skylab in a moment.
And I asked him in class, so, you know, how often did you use your scientific training in orbit? And he immediately shot back, never. you know, we were pulling out other people's automated experiments and, you know, basically setting them in motion. But he said, I was able to talk to the scientists on the ground a lot more intelligently than my engineering colleagues, because I understood the language and the goals that they had and whatnot. So,
Skylab, which is generally part of this course, because it was originally known as Apollo Applications.
It was launched by a satellite.
Right. So, and Skylab really was a turning point in this view about doing science as opposed to following through on rigorously prescribed checklists. People like Owen Garriott, who was a solar physicist from Stanford, Joe Kerwin, who was an MD, made a real difference by being able to use their scientific background to work with the ground. But that happened on Skylab, which of course, after the strike, we'll talk about that later, after the strike on Skylab, ended up being a domain whereby the crew had the time to go and look into things a little bit more deeply and relook at them the next day. Wasn't quite as pressured as the day-to-day obligations of Apollo.
And you know, it's also true that in
almost any expeditionary science, where people are going out into the field, which is especially today fairly expensive, you know, the goal is to get the data. And obviously you want to look at it enough to know that you're getting the right data and maybe make some changes, but you know, a lot of these things are highly optimized to get results. I mean, and even on Apollo 11, what's the first thing that Armstrong did when he stepped off the ladder? He leaned over, he picked up two racks and he stuck them in a bag and put it in his pocket, because they still thought they might have to leave any second, and if they had that kind of emergency, they didn't want to leave without the rock. So there's this almost like fractal scheduling that you do, where you always get the minimum to say you had a successful mission, and then you kind of expand and you expand and you expand. And in a lot of those cases, I work a lot on oceanographic projects, there's not a lot of time for analysis. You put the samples in the can, you label them, you treat them however they need to be stabilized, and you keep going, because the field time is very expensive, and you don't want to do a lot of analysis. Anything else about Elbaz?
I thought the conversation on the development of remote sensing and this sort of comparison to the desert environments of how much the situation they had to deal with mapping the moon really informed their studies of Earth. And I thought it was an interesting foray in the reading they were talking about the LOR decision, whether the moon was, well, a lot of what he said, whether it was, you know, only dust or, you know, loose collections of rocks, and I forget who had the quote, but you know, it's got to look like Arizona. It's got to be like Arizona.
Yeah.
But you know, just how closely those two were tied, and how, I guess, transportable knowledge was from one.
Although I wanted to ask him about that, because in his comments,
actually, he was very, to him, the big analogy was Mars with deserts, and because there's an atmosphere and there's, you know, the history. And I wonder about the moon, because it really is pretty strange from an earthly point of view, being in a vacuum and absence of a lot of things.
From that perspective, I was surprised, because he actually did draw some comparisons between the moon and Mars in a terrain sense. And that's not something you expect or hear, because of the atmospheric size formation difference.
Yeah. Anything else?
The thing that surprised me, that I thought was kind of backwards from how I expected it, was the development of remote sensing technologies was for the moon, not for the Earth.
Yeah.
And they were later taken from the moon mission and applied to the Earth,
yeah,
rather than the other way around, for mapping and
Yeah, that is interesting. And I suspect, if we had more time, I would ask him, that he was probably involved in the early Landsat work
and had some input into that, which came really on the heels of Apollo. And it is an interesting story that's...
Just to add on to that, I agree that it's interesting how much they put into the Apollo thing, but in light of Corona, I wouldn't be surprised if some of the things that ended up in Apollo are very similar to what was designed for Corona. Keep in mind that Corona's running basically 64, something like that, all the way through this time. So there is remote sensing going on around Earth. It's just all classified and of the Soviet Union.
Right. Well, that's true of the Hubble, you know.
You ever see a KH-11? It looks a lot like a Hubble. It's also just terrific to get a sense of his personality, which obviously probably hasn't changed at all from the Apollo days. And you really had this sense, and this is true of almost every guest we have, you can kind of place that personality into the history, and you understand how this guy who was young and kind of hired at Bellcom from Egypt and whatnot just ended up being so central. He just has this intellectual charisma, which they think they captured in the Tom Hanks thing, and clearly came across there.
Yeah, I can see how He went from knowing very little about the moon, he wasn't a lunar expert, to being one of the foremost scientists just by bringing together all the people around him, being able to explain things very well, and just having this energy and interest. And I can see how he really moved up the ranks very quickly.
Yeah.
It's also interesting, and I didn't anticipate this till he said it, and then I was like, of course, that coming from the Middle East, you know, he had a window into the target audience for Apollo, which even particularly in Egypt, they were sort of on the fence between Soviet alliance and American alliance during those years. And, you know, he told that story about the sort of Bedouin who he ran into, and had a very, very clear sense of what the impact of the program was in a part of the world that was, again, very explicitly the target audience, but it's not an easy thing to study, and he had a very clear idea of that.
I appreciated not just his personality, but he also, I felt, humanized the astronauts to a greater degree than we've experienced thus far. Like some of the anecdotes he shared, especially about like Jack Swigert. Mm-hmm. I mean, so often you read about him, and I feel like not sort of like a hero mentality, but they're kind of sterile, the descriptions of the astronauts sometimes when you read about them. So to actually get like a personal anecdote was really nice. Kind of puts everything into context.
And you know, there's a lot of difference in the level
of interest they had in different aspects of the mission. Some of them were really technical test pilot types who really were deeply immersed in the hardware. Others really took on the geology. You know, I mean, I think Dave Scott always interested me because of the computer stuff. He really took to the computer in a way that few of the others did, whereas the other groups were interested. I mean, Aldrin was into the rendezvous stuff. That was his expertise. And, you know, they weren't uniform people at all. They had their own pieces.
Saying like the astronauts didn't know anything about like lunar geology and they didn't care. Mm-hmm. And then so then he talks about how he basically played on their competitive natures. And
yeah.
Like, well, I just invited this one guy this one time. And then he asked if he could do it again. And then pretty soon it's just like this competition. It's like he knew exactly how to get to these guys and to get them to like.
And who was his key constituents among the crews? CSM pilots.
Yeah.
Because they were worried that
they had nothing to do and really wanted to show that they could do something useful. And when he offered them a way to do that, then he really had their attention. Mattingly, Warden, Roussa.
Well, just his ability to be manipulative.
Yeah.
That's true. Although, again, you know, these things are all, especially, and I'm sure some of you either have or will, you land in a project in its early stages. Everybody has their assignment about what they're supposed to do, but it's often also pretty chaotic and people don't really understand exactly what needs to be done. And then it's to some degree up to people to create their jobs. And he had an unusual position. I was interested in what he said. I had actually not put it together that they were physically located at NASA headquarters coming from Bellcom. But the way he talked about that was an advantage because in the field everyone thought you were from headquarters, but at headquarters you didn't work for the boss, so you could speak your mind. And this kind of institutional positioning of all these people is actually also very relevant and interesting. I mean, it was a real treat to have him. We'd not had him come into class before, and I had not heard him talk about Apollo before, so that was real special for me. I hope it was for you as well. Then to the topic for today. I'm always struck going through this, like, it's just such an interesting topic, and it's such an interesting moment in the program. And at some level, from the, you know, it's almost the key moment in the kind of large-scale engineering. It is the key moment in the large-scale engineering of it. And also, though, as an example of an engineering decision made in a large-scale system, it's pretty rare that you can get them as well documented as LOR decision has been. That's generally true of the Apollo program. It's one of the reasons I wrote a book about it. I mean, obviously I'm interested in the moon and I think the whole history is fascinating, but if you want to write about how big engineering projects work in the last 50 or 100 years, most of them don't have very good records. Most of them you don't have good access to the records. And most of the stuff wasn't very well documented. And even if you couldn't care less about the moon, and you couldn't care less about NASA, and you couldn't care less about space flight, There's all kinds of things about Apollo that you almost can't study any other way, just because it was so well documented, people did it afterward. NASA has a history program. They pay people to write little pamphlets like this. And so this case is really, I think, the kind of ultimate case study of an engineering decision in the complex systems world. You tend to get them in accident investigations, so the Columbia and Challenger reports have some similar levels of detail, but those things are by definition not normal. Whereas this one is, I don't know that there's anything outstanding about it in terms of how things work, other than it was just in this unusual project. And they seem to have made one. Whether they made the right decision or not is up for debate, but they certainly made one that worked, and that was their goal. So, you know, the Cox and Murray, in a way, both these two readings focus a little bit on priority, like whose idea was it, and who overruled it, and who pushed it forward, and there's a lot of debate about that. And anybody know who Jim Hansen is, by the way, who wrote this piece?
Yeah, he wrote the Neil Armstrong biography that came out a few years ago.
Although, again, part of the assignment is know the historian, know the source of it. So he's a accomplished aerospace and aviation historian. And he really went through and tried to sort through who paid attention to John Hubold, who ignored him, what happened, when, who deserves credit. And Hubold himself has a very particular view about that. Which we'll come to. But I also want to talk today a little bit about just what is the story. There's a lot of information there. And secondly, what really was at stake here, and how do we think about that story? Also, it's interesting, and I hadn't really remembered this, you begin to see the ways that the writing of the history starts to interact with each other. How could you see that in this readings?
Quotes, yeah. Different interpretations.
Siemens relies a lot on the Cox and Murray account, actually. And, you know, he has his own recollection, but then he's drawing on the way that they do it. I don't remember if he actually cites this paper in there. Actually, I'll tell you a funny story about Siemens, which was the first time we taught the class, we had him come in to do this lecture on the LOR decision, because he was there, and he had just published this book, the Tough Decisions book, and it's interesting because I went through my notes and almost everything he said in class then I read in here. So there wasn't much that I could bring you from class that was different from what you've read, but it was great to see him, and he shared a lot of insight about the program overall. And so we knew he was coming in to give this lecture. A bunch of our colleagues had asked if they could bring their seminar or whatever, and it was in this room, and it was completely packed, you know. And, you know, standing room only, people sitting everywhere. And I came in, you remember what happened? And Larry's standing at the door, and it was 1 o'clock, and he says, you know, Betty Siemens just called. Bob was driving down here, and his car got hit by a train. And he was basically 90 years old at that time already. And at that point, we already knew he was in the hospital, but he was okay. It wasn't a huge disaster. But here I was, the whole room was here full, and then I had to give the lecture on LOR instead of him without having prepared it. I mean, I had done the readings, which I think were the same as they are today, and it was a little bit intimidating to have this whole class together and kind of make it up as we went along. But and then eventually, not a month later, he did actually come into class. And
for those who have not made the connection, it's the same Bob Siemens after whom the laboratory on the ground floor of this building is named.
So he gave that sort of the story from his point of view, which is an important and interesting one, because again, Hubold is pretty critical of him in a lot of ways, and we'll look at that a little bit. So just to go through, let's start out and just talk about. Can I erase these? Does everybody have them? What are the advantages of the LOR mode? Okay. Mass reduction from Earth, particularly.
Need multiple launches.
Okay.
Didn't require the NOVA development.
Okay. Sort of related to this.
Redundancy.
Okay. What's the redundancy? Sorry? Yeah, it's interesting. You don't see that much in the documents. So how many of you read the two memos that are at the end of the enchanted round of view? Okay, we'll go through them a little bit later. They actually don't talk about redundancy. In retrospect, it's very obvious. And if you watch the Apollo 13 movie, they go, oh, wait, maybe we can just put them in the LEM and send them around as a lifeboat, and what a good idea. That was something they had planned in a lot of detail that was well known to them as an alternate mode. But there is, you don't get the sense from the documents about, gee, two life support systems, two computers, that has a big impact we'll see later on the computer development. Computers were identical, they're running different software, but they're identical hardware. Two guidance systems, two platforms, two of a lot of things. Of course, that's a good idea. It's not so clear in the decision documents that was a driver. What else?
Need for design trade-offs, because they could have an on-purpose lander, for example.
Okay, so special purpose vehicles.
And overall, is it general modularity
to the design?
Okay.
You could design each of the subsystems in with little overlapping with the others.
Okay. Yeah, it is interesting. Again, I mean, one of the things you see here, how many of you are in space architecture or working at Crawley's group or anything related to that? I mean, to some degree, this whole story is the birth of that whole sub-discipline, right? In fact, there was a student of Ed's, Ben Koo, who wrote his dissertation where he developed a kind of computer system for doing architectural studies. And in his dissertation, the LOR decision was the kind of case study he used, and by his rights, they came pretty close to the optimal architecture for that particular mission, to which I asked him at his defense, okay, so why do we need the computer system if a bunch of guys with slide rules basically figured it out? But now, this set of trade-offs is something that people do all the time, and there's formal methods for it, and there's actually formal diagrams for it and whatnot, and this is all sort of invented as it went. Nobody talked about it that way, but that's what was happening. So,
I was going to say, because of that modularity that helped to, or they saw that they would be able to accelerate the schedule or keep
okay.
The timing goals.
Mm-hmm. Other advantages?
To land, as opposed to trying to land a rocket for
okay.
a direct descent. They talked about visibility issues and astronauts wanting to pilot down to the moon.
Simplified the landing, which may have been one of the kind of initiating issues. Now, what's interesting about this, which is basically a pretty good cross section. We may come across some others of the. Engineering reasons to do this, is this really what convinced people to do it? Or put it a different way, what actually convinced people to do it? And I think part of the source of Hubolt's frustration is that, gee, all this was so obvious. And yet people didn't drop everything when they saw his argument and say, oh, of course we're going to do it that way. And that's really the story of, it's the story of the conflicting accounts between Hubolt's account and Siemens and even Faget's account, which is partly what, can we just close the door? Although it keeps a nice amount of air flowing through the room. The conflicting accounts, and also, you know, what was at stake for the people who had to make these decisions, and that's partly what I want to talk about today. Yeah.
Sure. I suspect it will be answered by your question.
Okay.
You may have heard of these famous articles from Collier's Magazine in the 50s, which, you know, not only informed the imagination of most of the people we're talking about, but pretty much informed U.S. space policy for the last 50 years. If you look at the progression of lunar to or orbital missions to shuttle to moon missions to shuttles to space stations, that's been, people followed the blueprint from these popular articles that von Braun and a few other people wrote in the 50s. So Collier's was sort of the equivalent of Life magazine. I'm not even sure if you guys know what Life magazine was. It was the equivalent of Facebook. Von Braun was a very skilled communicator, and actually we'll come back to that later in the term, later in the class today as well.
Do you want me to get into one of the Collier's issues?
Sure, if you have them in your office, yeah. They're valuable. I just dug out a couple of them, and they were also illustrated by famous either science fiction or space artists. I actually don't remember who did these particular ones. Chesley Bonestell was one of them. Space is a great topic historically also because, you know, it was very much people's imaginations were driving the engineering in a lot of cases. And almost all of the engineers themselves had read this either science fiction growing up or read these articles and this was the picture of how we might land on the moon. There were lots of different pictures of it, but this is a typical one. And you have these sort of giant landers coming down. That's the sort of human scale right there. And this is, of course, what it was going to look like. And this is even another one, which I like a lot. And Willie Ley was a kind of famous popularizer of space science and whatnot. This was his view of what a spacecraft might look like. And I think the readings for next week or even next Thursday includes the chapter from my book where I talk about this image. It's really interesting because, I mean, first of all, there's like 16 people or something who are landing. Not a single one of them is listed as a pilot. This one is actually, you can't see it here, but the face is von Braun's face, is the commander sitting in this kind of optical chair that has all these telescopes attached to it, which is more or less based on a World War II fire control computer. And there are doctors and geologists and photographers, no pilots, a guy navigating by celestial navigation, even with a little inertial platform there. And there was another one, I think Willie Ley is, maybe that's von Braun, and the face of Willie Ley is in one of these as well. I think that's Willie Ley right there.
I think it's this guy right there, yeah.
You know, the idea was you'd have this spacecraft, and I didn't capture, but you've seen these pictures of these beautiful, sleek rockets that all look just like V2s, landed on the moon, and then the people get out from the top, and they look down three stories, and the problem is, how do you get there? But these were the kinds of, and you can find many others, this was the sort of picture of what it was going to be like. You have this crew capsule up on top that's sort of commanding the territory, a little bit like a cockpit in an aircraft and whatnot. And that's what people had in mind. And I think one of the things that's so interesting about the LOR decision is, among other things, and I asked what are the stakes, and we'll sort of go through and list some of them. One of the things that's at stake is it's the moment that these kind of fantasy visions of spaceflight, which, again, all the engineers have that in their mind, too. It's not just people who read magazines, meet with this kind of real-world engineering problem-solving, and they have to kind of let go of some of these pictures in favor of, I mean, an image that is still pretty interesting and strange, but not what people expected, right? The LOR decision is about, you mean instead of this grand rocket, we're going to land in this dorky little thing that is sort of blows up like a balloon? That was a pretty big shift in mindset. And one of the things that you're seeing occurring through this process is how people can kind of come to that mindset. And again, obviously a testament to the people involved that they were able to do that with all of these different pressures on them and whatnot. But it really meant this wasn't going to happen, right? And that's a pretty big shift. So just go through a little bit of the, you don't need to follow every last committee and every last thing, and it can be pretty dizzying to follow the number of different reviews, although again, how many people have been in projects where there's a review, and then there's another review, and there's another review committee, and you know, it's not unusual that way. Every time is going to be the last one, and I do a lot of those here, actually. I'm doing one now, and it's sort of like, oh yeah, we're reviewing this thing, and it's been reviewed every 5 years for the last 20 years. What are we going to say that's different about? So this is sort of pre-Kennedy decision. A lot of this comes out of Langley. Again, that's kind of interesting. Hansen talks about the change in mind step to think about all these different pieces from the aeronautical engineers. The theoretical mechanics division is sort of beginning to do this. This is, you find Hubolt on this list in the 50s, late 50s. Talks about a lunar-related program. Here are a whole bunch of other studies. I'm trying to remember in which of the readings it was, but one of the people involved said, it's not like... they said, you're going to make the astronaut have to jump out of a plane without a parachute. And he says, no, it's much more like a ship coming into a harbor and a little rowboat going out and coming back. So even the metaphors they're using are sort of trying to get their head around what the problem is. And here are these three different modes. Okay, direct descent, that's really the one with, although these are sort of both that way, the giant Earth-based vehicle landing on the moon. Very interesting, too, that how focused they were on the physical human factors problems of the landing for that. How are the crews, if they're lying on their backs, which they have to do to do a safe launch, how are they going to see out and how are they going to land? Today, you could say, gee, if you want to do it that way, just make an automatic landing, give them a video display. They don't have to be facing, looking out the window necessarily. Problem solved, right? But the idea that they might, it wasn't technically easy or even feasible at that time. And, this is the sort of classic one. We can sort of pass these around. Well, maybe if that's okay with you, Larry. Here's one of the original Colliers from 1953. There's your rocket, suspiciously like the V2. There's your tracking station, suspiciously like the SCR-584 tracking radar that was designed here during World War II. And all the computer control systems and whatnot. And just one good sense of the...
Here, only 7 years after these guys left Peenemunde.
Right.
And the State Department had succeeded in keeping their wartime record pretty secret.
Here's another, is that a copy of them? So here are your three modes. You all basically, I lost my chalk. Get that. This one, what is the big issue with EOR?
Depending on what booster they were going to use?
Yeah, it requires multiple launches from Earth. To the end of the shuttle program,
they weren't able to launch any closer than many weeks apart. And that's with 40 years of experience with it. It was a big challenge at the time. How are you going to put two vehicles in the queue at the same time? And it was actually done with Gemini subsequently, pretty close back to back. But that was a much simpler vehicle than the Saturns. And even today, and one of our colleagues, Annalisa Weigel's done some quantitative look at this, you know, it's not at all clear this is something you'd want to do, just given even 1%, much less 10% probability of failure of any given launch. You can get yourself into some pretty hairy situations pretty quickly if you have a launch failure where you end up having stuff stranded in orbit and you do the numbers on how many you need to do and what the costs are. It's a tough problem. And then LOR here. So Hubolt, again, interestingly, a civil engineer, had some experience in England and in Zurich, essentially no very quantitative background, theoretical background, but not an astrodynamics background, and went through and sort of started from the beginning and tried to understand it, and starts looking at this rendezvous problem. He's still alive, by the way, and one of the students the first year in the class interviewed him. He's retired in Maine, and I haven't heard that he's passed away since that, and a really interesting interview. So, again, we don't need to follow all these details, but early looks at the problem, a lot of different ways to talk about where it originated. Again, one of the interesting things, lots of different steering groups. Space Task Group in 1960 begins looking at it, and toward 1961 is when it really begins to get interesting. These early conferences are really interesting. They mentioned a bunch of times in the reading, the 1961, 62. I'll talk when we talk about landing, about the early landing conferences. And just they bring industry in the room and they say, here's the problem, let's work it through. And you can see through the proceedings how they're thinking about that stuff. Again, direct descent produces what everybody thinks a rocket should look like, right? You put the people at the top. You put the engines at the bottom, you got big legs. You can see how it, even in this early picture, it's sort of a hybrid of what became the LEM and the command module. And they go up, they back down, they come home. And here is just one, this is a pretty early one, but comparison of what you need to land on the moon for the LOR versus a direct descent. And of course, now you can say, in fact, we really didn't say this, but it's sort of related to this, is the less mass you have to put into that gravity well, the less mass you have to get out of that gravity well, and the multipliers are pretty big as far as propellant, especially when you back that down to Earth. So trying to get all this stuff off the moon, why bother? And again, we're used to thinking about, these were their terminology at the time. This is, of course, the Saturn V and the Saturn I, but this was the natural trajectory. And this was what von Braun and his team had their sights on. So what was at stake for them?
Future employment?
Future employment, even more than that. I mean, accepting LOR for the Huntsville team meant abandoning Nova. Right? And so this is their dream. This is where they're going. This is the logical progression. This is what's going to explore the universe, get them to Mars, et cetera, et cetera. And here these practical things come in. And we'll go through the memo in a little bit.
And, you know, you can imagine how tough it must have been for him personally and also for the group in general to say, you know, gee, you know, if we accept this, they had every reason to say no. For no reasons like this, other than, you know, again, this is not an advantage for them. This is a horrible tragedy in some ways, a big disappointment. And, you know, in a real way, because I think, what's one of the other implications of LOR? Which also kind of relates to this one. Sorry.
You can't use the same vehicle.
Yeah, it's a very specialized solution. Okay, it's also the moment, and in some way, this is why I think the legacy of it is a little ambiguous, because in addition to getting you to the moon and getting there before the decade is out, there's a certain sense where you're also abandoning the future space program of the country, right? And some of the problems that we've had after Apollo are in some way traceable to this decision, because instead of saying, we're just going to build the biggest rocket we can possibly imagine, and then we'll be able to do all kinds of neat stuff with it, we say, we're going to build this highly optimized, very tightly engineered thing to get us there before the decade is out. And there's a case to be made that that was meant sacrificing the future, because it produced such a specialized solution for the Apollo program, for Kennedy's mission there. Again, what's at stake here? That's a pretty big stake, right? Yeah.
When you say sacrifice the future, are you specifically referring to like putting a space station in orbit earlier than they did with Skylab, or
not necessarily that? But you know, what is the growth potential of the Apollo system? And they begin looking at this in the late 60s, early 70s. And you know, actually, I raised this with Bob Siemens, and he responded strongly. He said, no. We had all kinds of follow-ons. Larry mentioned Skylab was the Apollo applications program. But it wasn't going to get you to Mars, and you weren't going to build, you know, lots of different kinds of missions on it. I've seen the studies. They involve things like sending multiple autonomous landers and building groups of landers to lunar, expanded lunar missions. But you're pretty locked into what you committed, right? It's a pretty specialized solution. And again, I think the psychology of the space shuttle reflects that in like, okay, we did this kind of one-off, very point solution thing. Now we're going to build this general purpose space truck that's going to allow us to do all this other stuff. It's all the same people, by the way, right? Faget and George Lowe and, you know, same designers. But they kind of react in the other direction almost, and they say, let's build this perfectly generic thing and give up, and with all the performance compromises that that involves. Again, this is sort of pretty familiar at this point. One thing to note here, actually, which is it's just nicely illustrated, that'll come up in the guidance thing, is the entire mission really takes place in one plane. There's very little orbital plane change, which has a lot of implications for the guidance system. And that's one of the that's the reason they end up using three gimbals instead of four, which has all kinds of crops up in Apollo 13 as a gimbal lock problem and stuff like that. Yep.
So if we can go back one slide for a second. I think it's probably should also be pointed out, I'm not sure it's clear that they could have built Nova. I mean, so if you look at those, they're the same height, effectively, 280 versus 270. You're talking about a 50-foot diameter rocket. And we already know that the Saturn V was extremely challenging to build.
Yeah.
And they built it and it worked. But can you put a 50-foot diameter rocket on a train to take it to the Cape? I don't think you can.
What's one of the really mundane problems that, that they had, if you read that memo at the end? Sorry?
Like on transport?
Nope. We'll come to it. Like really ordinary stuff also forced this change. But yeah, we don't know. It was never tried.
But to kind of expand on that, the shuttle only ended up having 20,000 or 30,000 pounds of payload.
Mm-hmm.
The Saturn V has, what, 170,000 pounds
of
payload? So like, yeah, it's a specialized solution in the sense that they came up with this thing that could take you to the moon, but you really could put anything on the top of that.
No,
thing.
That is correct, right? And actually, you know, kind of this piece right here is the lift capability, and it's this stuff that ends up being so specialized that you use it for Apollo Soyuz, and that's about the end of it.
Right. And they could have used this rocket with a different architecture.
Yeah,
I think.
Right. And this rocket was already built or already on the drawing boards, right, and well underway, and is. As Tilko sort of explained, like this rocket predates the Kennedy decision to a large degree. They wouldn't have been able to do it without having this already in the works.
I forgot. Are you going to talk more about von Braun later? Or
yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
We didn't. I often have a lecture about the whole Peenemunde team, which because of scheduling and whatnot
some of that
this year
in,
cut
in
out.
In the reading for the talk I gave last week.
Go. So Hubolt has this crusade, right? He presents this paper, and this is a lovely little description of systems engineering. Lunar Orbit Rendezvous offered a chain of reaction simplification on all back effects. You know, if you can really do this, you sort of think through its effects on the whole system, and there's a lot of good things that happen. And you know, I vowed to dedicate myself to the task. And then he does this sort of roadshow kind of thing of just briefing all these different people about this idea and advocating. Again, not uncommon, right? Especially an unusual new idea requires a person to advocate, you know, tirelessly for it at all these different venues, including, you know, getting hammered with this famous line, "His figures lie," from Max Faget. Who is Faget?
He's one of the like primary designers and sort of big picture engineers that they have at what later became Johnson.
Right. Coming out of Langley, interestingly enough. But
and there's that nice piece in Murray and Cox about Faget and Cadwell Johnson and their kind of synergistic relationship. But very kind of design type engineers, not analytical in the way that Hubbelt was. And that's part of the conflict there too, although there's other types of conflicts also. And this is the kind of famous photograph, which is the cover of the Hansen thing. And then, of course, you know, one of the things you fight, if you say pluses, minus, obviously there's a complexity issue, which is not trivial. What does it take to have two spacecraft, all the interfaces? Just the docking hardware is fairly heavy. Nobody understood exactly how. Yep.
So in the Hansen piece, it actually talked about some of the engineers, at least at the time of the writing, claimed that a trade-off analysis had not actually been conducted between the complexities inherent in redundancies in terms of like the life support systems and the guidance, the electronics, and the associated cost.
Mm-hmm.
Is that just like sour grapes on the part of people who didn't see their idea realized, or is there any validity to that claim?
Well, I think there's validity to the claim. Again, it sort of comes down to what's one of the big drawbacks is this, you know, well, the same thing is like the lunar orbit rendezvous is a big concern for people because of the risk, because of doing something unknown far away. How do you quantify that risk? How do you compare that risk against 1,100 pounds of docking hardware or whatever? There's no real quantitative way to do that, especially given that, you know, nobody has done it. Over the next few years with Gemini, they begin to radically reduce the risk of rendezvous and understand that it's very doable. But, you know, you're comparing apples and oranges, and the only way to do that in a certain way is by these kind of processes of people who have experience and hacking it through. And right here they sort of, if the price you have to pay is one extra crew compartment, two additional guidance systems, electrical supply, are you still on the plus side of that trade-off? The critics in the early debate murdered Hubbelt. That's von Braun talking, right? So what does that cost you? You know, and then the other big issue for all of this is just risk. And it's both program risk as far as are the contractors going to be able to build the right thing in the right amount of time, and just straight operational risk, or are the people going to die up there? Murray and Cox have that great story, which as far as I can tell is accurate, of what is the risk for the program, right? We can make the risk zero because you don't get that far into the weeds before you have to know, is this a 1 in 10 kind of failure thing we're building, or is it a 1 in 50,000 kind of thing? And the answer is 0.999 for astronauts' lives, 0.99 for mission success, okay? Got to have some number completely picked out of thin air in a certain way, but you got to start somewhere. Huge issue again when we start looking at the computer, how reliable is reliable enough? They're beginning to start to understand how to do that quantitatively, and the difference between 1 in 1,000 and 1 in 50,000 is millions and millions of dollars. This is what I call the kind of lone genius view of this story, which is Hubbelt's story, understandably so. And this is a quote from page 14 in Chain of Rendezvous. Hubbelt felt strongly if he could just persuade Gilruth's people to do their homework, they would become convinced of its merits, right? You know, all this stuff should just speak for itself. I don't understand why they can't see it. If I do the numbers and if they see it, the numbers, it will be obvious. Yet there was virtually universal opposition. They wouldn't even study it. It was only my perseverance that caused the STG to study and realize the merits of the plan. It was my own in-depth analysis and my crusading that paved the way for the acceptance of the scheme. And if it wasn't for me, they never would have made it. Okay, a very compelling story. You see it all the time in stories of technological development, the kind of lone inventor, the lone genius against the resistance of the world and all of the entrenched conservatism. Then if you go, let's see, there's a section in. You know, and again, even built into this story are a lot of the tensions we've been talking about before. I encourage you, if you haven't, to read Hubolt's memo that's in the back of the book. It's very much written from this point of view, right? And very, like, pulling no punches. He calls it like he sees it, and he's not happy with what he sees. And I'll just read you one piece because it relates to this whole business that we talked about last week about systems engineering and what are the issues and what are the kind of tensions around bringing in these fancy systems engineers like Joe Shea, like George Mueller, like Sam Phillips. And this is on page 4 of his memo. There's no page number. You know, perk chart folly is the title. Everybody know what a perk chart is? It's the, you know, these big charts that, like, Microsoft Project generates these perk charts. And it was a sort of hallmark of systems engineering. When one examines the various program schedules that have been advanced, he cannot help from being impressed by the optimism shown. The remarkable aspect is that the more remote the year, the bolder the schedule becomes. This is in large measure due to the PERT chart craze. It's become the vogue to subject practically everything to a PERT chart analysis, whether it means anything or not. Those who apply or make use of it seem to be overcome by a form of self-hypnosis or more or less accepting of the point of view. Because PERT says so, it is so. Somehow, perhaps unfortunately, the year 1967 was mentioned as the target year for putting a man on the moon. And the extensive PERT chart analysis then proved this could be done. One cannot help but get the feeling that if the year 1966 had been mentioned, then that date would have been proven. Likewise, if the date had been 1968. So, you know, what you see there is this kind of general skepticism of what is right at that moment kind of growing as this systems management of Apollo. And all those people, including Bob Siemens, are the people who are holding him back and holding his kind of genius back. And why are they not accepting his idea? And again, I think one of the ways to look at this question is to talk about what was at stake for all those people. Why is this a tough decision, right? That's the name of Siemens' book, right? And he devotes the longest chapter in the book to the LOR decision. And Hansen has a nice little riff on it, and he says, you know, Hubolt was a brilliant engineering analyst, an energetic, persistent, and often eloquent advocate of the causes he espoused, but not a shrewd behind-the-scenes player of institutional politics. And he says, what were the politics? They centered on the concern over where the work for the overall lunar program is going to be performed. Was it going to be conducted primarily by the people and organizations who built rockets, i.e. von Braun and his work, or other people who do other kinds of things? So let's start to make a little list of what the stakes are. And obviously you can kind of extend that to the sort of in vogue term today of stakeholders. What's at issue? One of them is just, as we mentioned, the imagination of what's it going to look like to fly to the moon. It's going to be a little bit stranger and different from what we expect. You know, whether to build the Nova or not. And that is related to what's the long-term vision of U.S. space policy. There Hansen is saying, you know, who's in charge? And for each stakeholder, you can think of at least one, if not several more, of those kind of stakes. So here's Gilruth, head of the Space Task Group. He's worried about mission reliability and flight safety. You know, avoiding the difficulty of developing a reliable Nova-class vehicle. So again, in the abstract, maybe LOR is not the best way, but in the practical sense, if we had forever and infinite money, it's probably the wrong way to go, but we don't have forever and we don't have infinite money. Maybe it's better. And then he says, I liked it from the beginning. Again, there's a lot of, as you think about how to tell these stories, there's revisionism in people's minds. None of it dishonest, but all of it sort of remembering certain ways. But again, just because it seemed to add up on paper wasn't enough to persuade people without addressing what some of these stakes are. So here's more, again, mostly detail. Hobolt's letter to Siemens, that's the one I just read from in 1961. So let's look at the dates here. What's relevant about that date? Yeah, I mean, it's that critical month. It's a week before Kennedy's speech. And so they're thinking very hard about it. Probably by this point, they know something big is in the works. Although Siemens will say, again, you know, I was on the NASA plane and I heard Kennedy's speech and we listened to it on AM radio and I was shocked and I said, we better land and get busy. So they didn't all know it was exactly coming. And then a bunch of different decisions. Again, trying to look at the lone genius view gets a little bit spread out by all these different mode studies. And you go to the archives and there's hundreds of these things. There's, you know, lots of different studies, lots of different mode studies. They're very good at generating paper. And there's a lot of different ways to think about it. And here's what Siemens had to say about that. This is the memo he wrote, that I was a voice in the wilderness. Maybe you think you're dealing with a crank, and I saw great merit in it. And this is what he says we ought to do. And I probably won't go through that memo in as great detail because he does mix a lot of different issues in there with the boosters. The von Braun memo we'll look at more closely in a little bit. He wrote a 97-page report, explained it all to me. You know, again, biggest stumbling block was the requirement for successful rendezvous in orbit. So the risk question, which is pretty subjective, right? You don't, especially then without anything to go on, nobody knew how hard it was going to be. And elsewhere he says, but I thought rendezvous could be done. I did a lot of that. Siemens wrote an autobiography before he wrote this book that we read for today. It's called Aiming at Targets. Because he worked on anti-aircraft computers during the Second World War, and you're trying to get a shell to hit an airplane, and the sort of theme of his autobiography is that's pretty similar to try to get two vehicles to rendezvous in orbit. So that was a problem I was familiar with thinking about. But you know, there was a lot of risk in the rendezvous. But geez, risk. You know, this whole thing is so incredibly risky. Who's to say? And if you can go back now, and we'll do this over the course of the term. Look at the single point failures in the Apollo mission. They're all over the place. So what's the big deal about adding one more? You know, I may have mentioned this before. If an astronaut was out on the doing an EVA on the surface and they broke their leg, they're dead. If they couldn't climb that ladder, there was absolutely the other guy couldn't lift them up. We'd probably never accept that today, but that was something people live with. So this is actually Siemens' account still. He refers to the Murray and Cox account, talks about the different hours of meetings, and then it sort of comes down to trying to convince the von Braun group. And, you know, what do we have to do to get them to sign on? We found it skeptical initial. Now you're looking at July 62, so it's really a year after the Kennedy speech this has been going on. As we look, we mentioned this before, the Apollo guidance computer contract is let in August of 61. A few months later, the North American Aviation contract is let. They're building the stuff, and they still haven't decided how we're going to land. And anybody who's going to work on the implications of LOR is already going to be behind. And so raises another good point. You know, think about North American. What's at stake for them in LOR? And they're at this meeting. Harrison Storms is the famous, yeah?
They lose some of the scope of the project?
Yeah, they lose the scope. You know, they just got this shiny brand new contract to build this shiny spacecraft to take people to the moon. What does LOR mean for them?
Your spaceship isn't going to land on the moon. It's going to go up there and fly around and come back. And you get de-scoped by 50%. So obviously, sort of who's in charge, who's building what? And I think it was in the Hansen reading, they talk about Harrison Storms at that meeting being pretty skeptical. They just don't see it, and it costs them a great deal. But they're also part of the problem. So just to sort of think a little bit more then about what are the stakes. So the Von Braun team is got to give up on Nova. The North American's got to give up on building a lander. It's going to be a different looking thing. What else is there for people? One of the other pieces, it's not so much one of the stakes, but we didn't really talk about this. It comes under here a little bit. They didn't have a lot of confidence that North American was going to deliver. Okay, and throughout the documents that you see later, I see it in the people who are building the computer, North American is seen as being in over their head and late and just sort of out of their depth. And the Apollo fire is really where that all comes to head. And one of the things that really sells them on this, and we didn't really talk about it, is just this parallel development. You split these things out, and now you have two contractors instead of one. Not happy for North American, more complex to manage, but you have a lot of things happening at once. So it's worth then, I want to take a look at the Von Braun memo that he writes, because it's, so this is from the back of the Hansen piece. And these are Von Braun's remarks, although they don't read like they're transcribed from a written thing. They read like they were written out. They probably were written after, about given to Shea and the sort of why they finally changed their mind. And it's worth reading because, for one thing, it's just a model of clarity of writing about why we're making this decision. You know, today you'd read this kind of document, it'd be like requirements, opportunities, challenges, threats, lots of kind of boilerplate language that would be sort of hard to say, what are they actually talking about? I don't know if Von Braun personally wrote this, but it's very well written and it's very crisp and clear. And here's what he says. Our general conclusion is that all four modes are technically feasible, right? This is not a hands down decision. And could be implemented with enough time and money. So it's not a matter of how to get to the moon in the abstract. We could do it any one of these ways. But we have these preferences, and I'm going to tell you why. LOR is first, EOR second, direct with Saturn V third, and then fourth is Nova. And then, of course, we just have to make this decision and go. We're losing time without it. And he goes, why do we think this? Highest confidence factor of successful accomplishment within the decade. Again, I think one of the things that's often overlooked about this decision is the huge role that the schedule, the end of the decade deadline played. There were higher risks in these ways, but overall they're willing to accept it because, you know, if you had two more years even, they feel like we could let North American go
and get the thing done, but we're so close. Also, this kind of modularity argument, separating the functions into two separate elements is bound to greatly simplify the development of the spacecraft system, right? Read between the lines. North American is not capable of designing a lander at the same time as designing the spacecraft itself. And by separating these two things out, we have parallel developments of the module. So they're persuaded by the management side, the program management side, as much as any of the weight arguments or the other more technical arguments. A whole bunch of interesting things to look at, just highlight a few of them. Also, again, management. The cleanest managerial interface between these places. Mostly focusing on the centers, not so much concerned with the contractors, which is interesting. Again, you've got, remember the sort of theme of the three cultures, the West Coast culture of systems engineering, which is sort of now coming in through headquarters, the Langley kind of hands-on types who are now getting ensconced in Houston, and the von Braun group. It's a commonly accepted fact, which is also interesting because, you know, this is systems engineering language, and systems engineering has only been around formally for about 10 years, but it's now a commonly accepted fact. The number and nature of the technical and managerial interfaces are very major factors in conducting a complex program. There are a frightening number of these, political language, the result of this is erosion of the authority vested in the line organization and the need for more meetings, integration groups, work out, da, da, da. So it's an argument for the simplification of the management structure as much as it is an argument about weight or launchers or that. He has all that in this document as well. Why we don't recommend EOR. We've been through some of that. It's worth reading. Why we don't recommend the direct mode. Interesting too, and it's sort of a sidelight, but it's what interests me, is the issue of automating the landing, right? Again, they feel like if they had a fully automatic landing, a lot of these modes would be easier, but since they feel the need to put the crews in the loop, the LOR landing is easier. And here they say, you know, we're going to give up on the Nova for the time being, but we don't want to lose it forever. We feel strongly that it's not the end of the line. Exclamation point. You don't see that too often, right? And so they still hold out hope, although I think realistically they knew that this was the program of the moment. And if you were going to give up your baby for that, maybe they had their hands full anyway. If you're going to give up your baby at the moment, you may not ever see it again. And then this is the sort of mundane thing I was referring to. The Michoud facility, which had just been built, or is even maybe still being built in Mississippi or Louisiana. Anybody ever been there? It's an old Army factory they converted. And you know, the rafter heights are 40 feet high, but a Nova is 50 feet. And we'd have to raise the roof if we were going to build the Nova, which you can imagine them also just kicking themselves saying, why didn't we think of that when we first designed the facility? Although that roof may be something that was inherited from the World War II facility they had inherited. But you can look at all of these grand issues and the kind of long-term history of the U.S. space program and so on and so forth, and some of it came down to the height of the roof in that particular high bay. Wasn't going to be easy to deal with.
The questions that the American engineers in White Sands asked von Braun when they finally came there about the fins, when von Braun pointed out that they were still using these rather small fins on the V2, small in terms of aerodynamic stabilization at high altitude. And the answer was that the fins were sized by the height of the railroad bridges in France.
Interesting. Yeah, I could never understand why the Saturn V fins were so small when I was a kid. didn't make any sense to me at all, and I learned how they actually did it.
One of my favorite topics, I'll show you a video of this, that sort of, to me, encapsulates a lot of the subtlety of the program, is that if you watch the Saturn V when it lifts off, anybody know what it does? What?
It tilts over 1 degree, just enough to drift a little bit to the side to clear the tower by a little bit right of margin, and then straightens up. You have to really know what you're looking at from the right angle to see that. But the fact that they could have that giant fiery thing with all these complicated gimbals and control it to the point it tilts over 1 degree and goes up is amazing to me. Even though it's pretty much like sophomore year controls problem, right? Try to do it with a F1 engine or five of them. So
again, you see the very smart comment by Hubolt about once you started to look at LOR, the advantages rippled through the program, they even rippled to this level. This is in his major memo, right? It's a serious consideration about how the system's going to evolve. That may be my last highlight in there, or there may be one at the end. I like this at the end too. So these are their final recommendations. And I think more than anything, this is the moment of the decision being made when the Von Braun team comes on so strongly. Adopt LOR, develop a fully an unmanned, fully automatic Saturn V that's a logistics vehicle that can be sent up, which is interesting from a controls point of view. Continue the C-1, make it into the Saturn I, make it into the 1B. Continue working on propulsion, and continue to work on the actual engines themselves. Signed Von Braun. If you haven't read the whole memo, you should, because it's just very clear. Think about today a program of this size with this many implications being shifted in its direction by, what, an 11-page memo written on a typewriter. That's how it worked. It was very simple and concise. Questions, comments?
So this is one of the things I wanted to ask about with the fully automated lunar excursion vehicle. What they're basically doing is saying, like, look, we could do a lot more if we didn't try to load everything on the same rocket.
Yeah.
However you put those things together, you can have a much bigger vehicle. I don't understand why it doesn't seem like there's any consideration to kind of a both Earth orbit and lunar orbit. So I understand right now, like, the objective is to get to the moon and land on the moon on a certain schedule, and that's kind of the driving consideration.
Yeah.
But wouldn't it have been useful to have a dedicated vehicle that takes you from Earth orbit to the moon? You go to it, you bring up your lunar lander and your command module, you stick them on the side of a larger craft, takes you over there, drop off the lunar module, come back up, come back to Earth, drop off the capsule to get back down to the Earth, instead of constantly discarding every piece of infrastructure you build for this program. You know, one of the problems with the entire Apollo thing is by the time they were done with it, they had nothing to show for all their effort.
Yeah.
You know, okay, we went to the moon, all the parts of it blew up or burned out or
went into orbit
around the sun, except for the ones we didn't use. You know, none of this stuff got...
Three we didn't use.
There's no... Yeah, okay, they launched Skylab eventually, but, you know, there's no other space infrastructure to show for the billions and billions of dollars they spent for it. You could have had a much bigger impact with...
Responses to that? Mike? Yeah?
Would that turn it into a multiple launch mission? Which would be a major trade to have. You talk about rendezvous with something in Earth orbit to then carry you to the moon, to then go down, do that mission architecture, then come back, get into something else and come back. You're either launching one massive vehicle that carries all your parts that then break up into bits. And even if you have reusable infrastructure, like you said, which would be a good idea for long term, it takes longer to develop and requires multiple launches to get started, which may have been a deciding factor.
I think also, I mean, without knowing
the numbers on that, the numbers are dominated by the fuel. And so whether you leave infrastructure in orbit or not, you know, it's where the fuel is going to come from and how you're going to get it up there. And it's only, I mean, in the last couple of years that there's serious, like, fuel transfer in orbit going on. And, you know, I suspect that that's why that wasn't considered that way. I will say this, though. So around when we first started teaching the class, MIT and Draper got a contract from NASA to look at, okay, we're going back to the moon, you know, let's look at these decisions. And first of all, it wasn't all that cut and dry, whether you would do LOR again if you were going to go again. And in our class, it was the second time I think we taught it, the final project was a competition to look at lunar landing architecture. And one of the teams was led by an extremely good student of Ed Crawley, Wilfred Hofstetter, who used to sit in the back in class, and he knew every last fact about Apollo. He corrected me all the time during my lectures. And he was a very, very smart guy. And they developed a lunar architecture that said, I wish I had a diagram for you, and I can dig up his paper. In the Apollo architecture, the translunar burn is done by the Saturn third stage, and then the Saturn third stage drops off, and the lunar orbital injection burn is done by the command module. Right, and there were reasons for that at the time, which I'm not even remembering. And he basically showed, if you build that third stage a little bigger, take it with you to the moon, turn it around, use that to do your lunar injection, that buys you thousands and thousands of pounds to the surface that you wouldn't have otherwise. And remember what the prize was for winning the competition that year? We brought him down
to NASA, and
he briefed the heads of the Space Exploration Directorate, who was Doug Cook and, you know, the people who were really doing it. And I went down with Wilfred to Washington, and we briefed it, and their response was, wow, that gives us a lot to think about that we had never thought about before. And I think eventually that got built into what was going to be the Constellation lunar architecture. It may have come from other places as well. So there are definitely other ways to skin that cat, and, you know, he made a very strong case for that.
Yep. A different thread. If I was doing a hybrid mode, that's what that B recommendation is for, yeah, a lunar surface rendezvous. It's like
that's exactly what that is. Yeah. And they did this.
Actually, I have, I have studies. I'll dig them out when we do the LEM, maybe, of exactly that, like a little campsite with automated LEMs. It wasn't very hard to automate the LEM, right? It may have been hard to land it super accurately. But if you leave that, you could land it in the Sea of Tranquility, no problem, by itself. We'll see that again when we talk about the computer. And little campsite with six or eight automated LEMs. You can spend a year getting them up there. And then the crew lands, and they've got all this great gear there, and either as a habitation module or whatnot. And that stuff was all in the study phase. And that's actually what Siemens, when I said, gee, do you think LOR kind of shortened the life of the viability of the hardware, that's what he was referring to when he said he didn't agree with that.
He doesn't say explicitly they're going to land. It's just a vehicle to support. They, you know, wonder why don't they build a station around the moon, which is like a fuel stop and a communications relay. And this letter is not specific to landing or just leaving something in orbit around the moon.
Well, I think the LOR
mode implies there's a lander there.
Support vehicle.
Oh, okay, yeah, I see. This could be an orbital
vehicle.
Well, I disagree, because earlier in the memo, it's under the why do we recommend LOR plus C5 one-way logistics vehicle. It's paragraph D. They specifically refers to the one-way logistics vehicle as the lander.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, you certainly could do it as an orbital vehicle, though.
Yeah.
Well, anything Skylab over the moon, basically.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, you start to begin to see how.
Again, and this is really the kind of genesis of the idea of space architecture. Given a set of possible vehicles and a set of mission profiles and a set of industries and schedules and costs, how do you come up with the optimal way to do this? It's not at all a trivial problem. It's not a trivial problem just from the point of view of propulsion, much less from the point of view of an interesting one that, you know, sort of related, although it's slightly off topic. Let me see if I can find one of the slides for you from you've all seen these pictures, right? And just talking about fuel, and I was always impressed when I was a kid at these crawlers, right? And God, it must, they just carry this impossibly heavy, huge thing out there and so on and so forth. But of course, the crawler is carrying an unfueled Saturn V. And I went through the numbers last night, and the unfueled Saturn V weighs like 200 tons, which is, what else weighs 200 tons? You know, is basically like a ship's worth of cargo. It's not a small ship's worth of cargo. It's not a very heavy weight. It's only when it gets out there and they fill it up with all these pipes that it weighs 3,000 tons. So all they're transporting with the crawler is this lightweight structure that's empty, you know, and it's not something I could lift by myself, but it's not exactly this enormous thing. The crawler needs to be precise, and it needs to keep it upright, and it needs to climb hills and stuff. But I always had the sense of like, oh my God, how can they move that impossibly heavy thing? It's really not particularly heavy at all. It's lightweight aerospace structure in the scheme of things.
But yeah. The mobile launch platform, the tower itself, I thought the whole transport load was 2 million pounds or something.
Is it, I mean, the tower is obviously much heavier.
Yeah. So, I mean, I don't, yeah. I still think that's non-trivial.
Yeah.
A couple million pounds.
But it's...
Was it a...
No, I think your point.
Yeah. my only point being how much the vehicle weight is dominated by fuel. What is that? 200 out of 3,000 is less than 1%.
Sort of a question from shuttle, actually. It's obviously painted white and black. I'm sure there's some sort of range safety reason for the black squares.
Yeah.
But why, if they had just not bothered painting it, how much extra payload could they put up?
So that's a really good question, actually. That's one of my little hobby horses.
In the shuttle program, they actually did that with the... If you look at the first shuttle mission,
yeah, they painted the tanks.
The tank is white, yeah. And all the rest of them is orange. And so, yeah, as well, if they don't paint it, it actually...
Well, and all the previous Gemini and Mercury, they're just naked
metal, right? Mercury and Gemini, they're not painted. And Apollo, they painted it. And the reason given is optical tracking, right? There are automated telescopes that you've seen the film from those things, and they're, you know, trying to lock on this target and so on and so forth. But it is an awfully large weight penalty. And my private theory is just white. Up until Apollo, the color of space was what? Silver, right? The Mercury suits are all silver. I think the Gemini suits are silver. That was the kind of futuristic. And with Apollo, with the kind of public mission of being civilian and good and clean, still to this day, you know, with the Navy talks about, you know, using a submarine that's non-combat. They talk about the white submarine is one that would purely do science. That's still the military term for not warlike. And that somewhere along the line, decision got made that Apollo was going to be white. The spacesuits are white. The interiors are all white, the vehicle is white. Because, I mean, it is an enormous load of paint, titanium dioxide paint. And I've never been able to find a document that proves or disproves my pet theory one way or the other. So it's still a theory, but.
I've got a question about
the
branding, if you will, of the Apollo program. So, just kind of back to the reading on the Soviet programs, it doesn't seem like much thought was given to Punk, but the circumstance to, you know, the outward appearance of even their launch hardware, it all seems kind of, to this day...
The Soviets?
Yes, the Soviet hardware. You know, when they rolled out a vehicle, it was kind of a
requiem rather than celebration. Whereas it seems to be quite the contrary with the NASA program. I mean, in your reading, is that a very strategic choice, or is it just
I mean, again, I've never seen that discussed, but again, you can
look even at those descriptions of Johnson and Faget as designers, and they were from this era where if it looked beautiful, that must be the best function, which was very popular, probably still is in aerodynamics, and you see like the JSF competition, which is now the F-35, you know, did you ever see the losing vehicle in that competition? It was one ugly airplane. The F-35 is not a pretty airplane either, but the competition was just, they ought to have known the Air Force was never going to buy that, right? There's my Air Force pilots. Not instead. So there was some element of that. I haven't looked enough at the design documents of the Huntsville group, and we talked a little bit about they have the kind of exterior structure philosophy with interior tankage as opposed to the slightly clunkier looking Atlas where it's more the balloon shape. There's always this tension in Apollo, and it comes to the fore in this story about there was no plan for cameras to be on the LEM, especially TV cameras. And that was something that the media people had to fight for at the last minute. And of course, the image of Armstrong walking off the ladder is like the famous image from Apollo, and that was a last-minute addition because the engineering teams really just didn't see it as a priority and didn't understand why it should be important. And that you can sort of see that throughout. Just to sort of follow up, July of 62, it's announced. There's still issues. There's this one. They talk a little bit about Jerry Wiesner, okay, which I always find this interesting because around here, Jerry Wiesner was a great hero for a lot of good reasons. He was president of MIT. He did a lot of great things on the campus that survived to this day. He was a very broad-thinking guy. In the Apollo story, he's, I wouldn't say a villain, but he's always the one they're having to fight against. He's the president's science advisor, and he objects to LOR, and he just doesn't... He objected, we saw this last week, to the Mercury and Gemini, and didn't think it was valuable. They still had to convince him. There's that great quote from Kennedy saying, well, I knew Webb would win because Webb had all the money and Jerry had none, and all he had was me. Larry?
Tremendous respect for Jerry Wiesner, brilliant engineer. I had a conversation with him shortly before he died about space station and planning. And he retained the same arguments that he had against Apollo for the same good reason. You know, it's a show. It is not to be confused with doing real science. It's too risky.
Is interesting because that's the typical position of the
scientific community, broadly based, toward human spaceflight. And in some sense, as the science advisor, that's the community that Wiesner was representing. But he himself was an electrical engineer. There's this very interesting moment which everybody remembers, which sort of raises these tensions, and I think this photograph is taken within a few minutes of when this happened, where Kennedy is touring around Marshall, I think it's Marshall, and the reporters are all there, and von Braun and Wiesner get into this kind of heated discussion in front of the reporters, and that's seen as a bad thing, and what if the president hears, and are you exposing internal rifts over the LOR issue to the press? And Wiesner sort of says, no. It was Webb who comes over and says, stop talking about this in this environment. This is not appropriate. Or it was Kennedy who stopped it. We're still working on it. And you could just imagine that scene. But again, it sort of highlights the dynamics going on. Eventually it is resolved, it's set in stone late in 62, and the contract to Grumman is let. And, okay, so now we're more than a full year into the full-on program, and Grumman is only getting started. Think of that scene that we saw at the beginning of the term. We got the contract, we're starting. You know, they're playing catch up from day one. And that filters through all the way through Apollo 8 when they don't do the lunar orbit mission because the LEM isn't going to be ready. And this is a variety, this is from astronautics.com, I think, of a whole bunch of the different landing modes envisioned. And this is the kind of contemporary image of how the stuff is all going to get packed in. Again, a fair amount of confidence in the on-orbit maneuvering. It's again something when I was a kid I had so much trouble figuring this out. It's very nicely depicted in the Apollo 13 movie. You got to pull the entire top of the stack out, turn it around and point it back in, and then dock in order to pull the LEM out. And you do that in Earth orbit before you head off to the moon. The astronauts love that, a lot of flying by hand. Dave Scott actually was the first person to do it, I think, so we can talk to him about that. And you end up with this kind of flight profile. And and all the different opinions about whether it would happen. A few observations about the willingness to challenge the bureaucracy, although again, I think that the bureaucracy had a lot to work through, and how they reached the right decision with a sort of painful and maybe ugly decision process, but.
It's interesting to me to contrast your first bullet and the fact that somebody who felt strongly about it could persist and go to higher levels, contrast that with the management structure which was in place and largely to blame for the Challenger accident, which I think you all know about, but engineers who felt strongly that there was a dangerous situation in terms of the O-rings and the cold weather and so on, just were not able to go beyond their immediate supervisors.
Or they chose not to.
Yeah.
So I have a particular opinion about the engineers in that particular case. But it is
relatively free-flowing organization in that sense. He was willing to write to Siemens, although Siemens' opinion was sort of like, he didn't need to write to me. It was all waking its way through the channels.
Actually, out of curiosity, I'm wondering if how much of the resistance that Hugo encountered was his persistence and willingness to go over people's heads, right?
Yeah.
Because, like, if I was another engineer who was supposed to be tasked with this, and I found out my boss's boss's boss had just been told that I was doing a bad job,
yeah,
I'm not sure I would have been terribly receptive to what that person
That's
had
correct.
To say.
Yeah.
So I wonder if maybe he tried not doing that, yeah, if he might have made a little bit more headway.
I always like to ask in these questions,
too. I mean, resistance to change, to me, is a pretty frail crutch on which to build a heroic story, right? Because, A, resistance to change is almost always the right response, and B, it just calling everybody else conservative, especially when those other people are Gilruth and Faget, and, you know, it doesn't really buy you much. It's more interesting to ask the same question, which is, why were people convinced eventually to accept the change? What actually made it for them? And you saw that in the case of the von Braun memo. What actually caused them to overcome their resistance? That's what's interesting to me. Yeah, there was a question here.
So, as I read through the readings, I noticed some parallels between Hubble's story and Brainerd Holmes' story, with the exception, I guess, that the Brainerd Holmes actually went public and made people look bad.
Yeah.
But do you think that that's the only difference? Do you think that that's the reason that Brainerd Holmes ended up sort of getting the boot? And
you know, it's very hard to tell because you don't know.
From the outside so far away, was he a competent manager or was he not a competent manager? It's very hard to read that much into that at the time. But, I mean, you're right. He took the heat for it. And, you know, I think one of the things you see here, I may have mentioned this early in the semester, you know, the whole principle behind Apollo was supposed to be that it demonstrated the superiority of the American system over the Soviet system. But I think you'll see when we look at the Soviet lunar program, The irony of that is that the Soviet program was very kind of free-flowing and organic, and there were lots of internal competitions, and the American program was, like, in the end, rigidly hierarchical, very tightly organized, very top-down, and that was how it succeeded, and that was how you had to do it to do a project like this. And one of the things you see with Holmes's firing is the kind of process by which people are sort of brought on board. And, you know, all of this parallels, and Siemens does a nice job of weaving it together. They're hiring Mueller, they're hiring Phillips. Shea is going to Houston with all the tension that comes out of that. And again, you know, these are not academic problems. Like, three people end up dying, and some people attribute it to those tensions and that kind of problem. So this is exactly the period, and it's a little bit later with the MIT folks because they're kind of off in the wilderness up here. But it goes from this kind of free-flowing, yeah, let's design this cool stuff, to like, we have a commitment to the country, we've got to get this project done. You know, let's get serious. Other questions, comments? Let me just have a quick look at my notes, see if I... Oh, you know, two other stakes, just by the way, just to keep in mind, we sort of talked about this, was, because this will come back, automatic versus manual landing is one of the things that's at stake. And another one, we sort of alluded to this, that Cox and Murray do a good job of, how do you measure risk? And it comes up again with the computer, this business between, is it a statistical measure or is it a designer's issue? And that they're very clear about how that played out in the overall spacecraft program. We'll see it again when we look at the computer design, but a lot of different opinions about how to do that. I think that's still an issue today, actually, that people encounter. Any closing comments, questions?
So I don't remember when the initial set of Apollo astronauts were selected, but is there any feedback from the astronaut crew?
They were selected, I don't know, offhand.
Remember, it was also right about this time, the new 9 and then the next 14. And the Mercury astronauts were fairly involved in, 60, 61, they're actually mostly in the queue flying. And you don't see them much in these documents. They weren't yet national heroes in a certain way, or they're just becoming that. I know in the computer stuff, they're coming to Cambridge all the time, giving feedback on what's going on. But you're right, you don't hear much about the astronauts having input into the LOR decision.
Rendezvous. You know who it was?
Aldrin.
Yeah, there was Aldrin. And back, you know, he and I were students together, and he was not shy about voicing his opinions. I'm sure it wasn't when he went to Houston.
Yeah, sometimes we'll show you the correspondence surrounding
when his dissertation was accepted at MIT. was Walter Wrigley and
Bob Halfman were his advisors, and they were a little hesitant to accept it. but again, you know, people like Aldrin would say, rendezvous, not a problem. You know, we'll work on that. And again, no
notion that there could be a computer in any of these discussions that would help you with the rendezvous. That's really the first thing the Gemini computer is. That's, by the way, another one of the stakes we should not forget to mention is once that decision is made, Gemini has a grand mission in life, right? Learn how to rendezvous. That's almost the entire description of the program. It's already well underway. It's going to happen. But now Gemini has a very clear thing to decide and prove. It's the one thing in Apollo that we haven't done that we're not sure how to do. And actually, that's a good segue, because next time we're going to talk about Gemini and go through some of that.
Of course, the Russians went and did it.
And they did it first. And they did it automated in before Apollo 11, right? 1967, I think, is the first automated rendezvous.
In terms of measuring risk, in one of the previous readings, you were talking about, like,
them sort of arbitrarily deciding on the 999 and the 99.
Yeah.
And then saying, like, well, we can't actually test every part, like, the amount of times that would be required to actually get to these numbers. So, like, at what point did they really just decide we've tested enough, or is, like, what's the rationale behind we've tested, like, this little part that will feed into this 999 number?
Yeah, that's a really good question, because it's also, like, the at that level, and it's still an issue today, the failure rates are that low, the statistics start to get pretty uncertain. That comes up in a lot. Again, we'll see it in the computer design, where the original plan is to send the computer up and send a box full of spares with a bunch of soldering irons and tools. So if the computer breaks, the crew members can pull out the boards and, you know, sit there and snip, snip, and put the resistor in. Then it kind of goes into, well, we'll just send up modules that'll be redundant. And then it's like, well, that's just going to weigh as much as a computer. Why don't you just put another computer in? And to some degree, LOR helps them solve that problem. We're going to put up two computers, although it's also the ground control. Actually, it's another interesting one is that in these conversations, the concern is that you'll have no tracking when you're going across the face of the moon doing the rendezvous. Actually, they end up with really good tracking, incredibly good tracking, because the electronics of the tracking developed so rapidly during the 60s that either if you're on the far side, you've got the inertial platform, and if you're on the front, you've got the radio tracking, and the tracking turns out to be really good in both cases. So all of these conversations are done sort of in the absence of an imagination of what a computer could do for you, B, what really good ground-based tracking could do for you, and they end up with both of them.
So in the initial discussions of LOR, a lot of naysayers were saying that Humboldt's calculations were too optimistic, that he wasn't considering a lot of additional weight that would come in the design. So who ended up being right? How close was his?
That's a good question.
I don't know. I think in the end, it was the schedule that drove it. But it was also true that, okay, you know, you buy these advantages buy you something, but then there are these costs, especially this one. And, you know, it's an analog thing, like when that complexity adds enough weight to make it not worth it, plus enough risk. And
one of the papers mentions that it ended up being that with the LOR that it weighed about as much as they predicted the single shot would have taken, except for, so like, they originally said LOR was going to be here and then ended up being here. They said that the single shot was going to be here, so which means it probably in reality would have been a lot heavier.
Yeah.
So relative to the stated design, it was much heavier than he said it would be, but relative to any real design of a single stage kind of operation, probably still would have been lighter.
It's interesting, in
the lunar lander they were building for the return to the moon, and I'm forgetting the name of the vehicle that John Connolly came and briefed us on. Do you remember? I have a signed photograph of it in my...
Yeah,
it wasn't LHAT, that's the basic technology.
Altair,
right. You know, they felt they couldn't go away from LOR because of this Apollo story. It had been sort of in stone, and that was partly what Wilford and his group were trying to argue against, which was just because it worked on Apollo doesn't mean it's always and forever the right way to do it. There are other things to consider. That was when I sort of felt, this is sort of a side anecdote, but that John Connolly, who was the head of that program, came and briefed the class one year, and the Altair was going to be four crew members to the surface. And somebody asked, why four? And they said, well, Apollo was two. We've got to be bigger than that. And that was sort of Mike Griffin's Apollo on steroids thing. That was the moment for me when I thought, this program is not well thought out. It doesn't have a clear mission. Just to do something a little better doesn't seem like a basis of national space policy. All right, see you Thursday.